Hey, Harsh here. Today we will be discussing about monoliths versus microservices, and by the end of this video you will understand what each one is, the pros and cons with proper examples, and most importantly when and why you might choose one over another. First up, let's talk about monolithic architecture. Think of it as a traditional departmental store. You walk in and everything is under the same roof. Clothes, electronics, home goods, food court, everything is under one roof. In software terms, a monolith is like a single large application where its different functions or modules like user authentication, product listings, like order processing, everything is bundled together in one big code base. So when you want to update an application, you have to deploy the entire unit. Why would you choose a monolith? Well, when you're starting out, it offers some clear advantages. Development is often simpler. Everything is in one place, so it is easier for a small team to build features and get started quickly. Performance can be super good because components within a monolith can communicate directly and very fast because they are part of the same process. There are no network calls involved. Debugging and testing can be straightforward. You can have and often trace issues through the entire system and run end-to-end tests more easily. And generally, there is less operational overhead to begin with. You only have one thing to deploy and monitor. This diagram shows Netflix's original monolithic application from their DVD by mail era, which lasted from 1997 to late 2000s. Everything lived in one massive application, like user authentication, order processing, payment handling, everything was tightly coupled together. When users borrowed movies or rented DVDs, all requests flowed through this single system that connected to one shared database. While simpler to develop and deploy initially, this architecture became challenging to scale as Netflix grew. Every small change required redeploying the entire application, and if one component failed, it could bring down the whole system. This eventually led Netflix to migrate to microservices architecture. As your application grows, the monolithic approach can start to show its cracks. Scalability becomes a problem. Imagine in our department store, in the food court, one specific shop gets super popular. You need to expand the whole store. That is kind of the issue of monoliths. You're often stuck with one technology stack. If your monolith is built in Java and you want to use Python for a machine learning feature, it's kind of tough. And it can have development slowdowns when the code base becomes too large, since it is harder for people to understand. There are certain reliability risks that if there is a bug in one module, it can kind of bring down the entire application. And developments become risky and slow. Even a tiny change means redeploying the whole application. Let's come to microservices. Think of this like a modern shopping mall. Instead of one giant department store, you have many smaller specialized stores, like a store for shoes, for books, for tech, and several restaurants, each operating independently, but overall contributing to the experience of the mall. In software terms, again, a microservice architecture breaks down a large application into a collection of smaller independent services. Each service is responsible for specific business function, like a user service, a product service, order service. They communicate with each other, usually over a network using APIs. Microservices bring some powerful advantage where monoliths fall short, especially for larger and more complex applications. You can scale your services independently. For example, if our order service is getting extremely popular due to a flash sale, we can just scale that service without touching the other ones. You also have technological diversity. Want to use Python for your recommendation engine and Java for your payment service? Go for it. Each service can use the tech best suited for its job. It also has better fault protection. If the recommendation service goes down, users can still browse products and place orders. The impact is contained. You can also have faster and independent deployments because teams can focus on specific services without impacting other ones. And this often leads to better team organization within a company, with smaller, more autonomous teams owning their services end-to-end. This shows how Uber's app actually works behind the scenes. When you request a ride, your app talks to Uber's API gateway. Think of it as a front door. From there, it splits into separate mini applications called microservices. The user service handles your profile. The location service tracks where you are. The matching service finds the nearby drivers. The trip service manages your ride details. The payment service processes your card. And notification service sends you updates. Each service has its own database and can be updated independently. The beauty of this is that if a payment system gets slowed down, you can still see the nearby drivers. If they need to update its location tracking, it still doesn't affect billing. This is why Uber rarely crashes, since each piece works independently. Now, there is nothing perfect in this world. Everything comes with its trade-offs. Microservices also have some. First of all, they introduce distributed system complexity. You're dealing with multiple moving parts and you need to find and talk to each other over network. This means worrying about network latency also, service discovery, and how services behave when others fail. There is also significant operational overhead. Instead of one application, you now have many services to deploy, monitor, log, and secure. Good DevOps teams are essential for microservices. Testing becomes more complex. How do you test a user journey that spans multiple services end to end? That kind of testing is much harder. There's also data consistency. We will cover this in future videos, but across different databases, as each service might have its own, it can be kind of tricky. And the communication between services can add latency and become a new point of failure. Okay, so the $1 million question, which one should you choose? And the classic answer in system design is it depends. Consider Monolith if you want to have an extremely fast development cycle, if you have a small project and minimum viable product. You can read this PPT, right? And consider microservices when you have a large application, you have a huge team, and you need independent scaling of components, right? For most of us, when we are working on our personal projects, it would be 100% monolith. There could be a one-off. There is always one-offs. And for microservices, it's basically massive teams, massive companies handling so many services together. Hey, if this video helped you understand this topic, don't forget to like and subscribe. You can also drop your suggestions down in the comments about the improvements and the topics you would like me to cover next. Till then, thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next one. Peace.